during the conference so far? It's my pleasure to bring up the person who is going to be introducing our next speaker, a woman who attended this conference herself 19 years ago and now serves on the YAF staff as Vice President and General Counsel. Please welcome Kimberly Begg.
Young America's Foundation has been blessed to partner with some of America's greatest thinkers and advocates for freedom throughout our history. William F. Buckley, Ronald Reagan, Russell Kirk, and Milton Friedman are among our country's most principled leaders who substantially advanced the cause of freedom through their thoughtful discourse and staunch commitment to spreading their ideas, especially to young people. Our next speaker carries on the tradition of these intellectual giants through his wisdom, courage, and leadership in advancing freedom and natural rights owed to all people. It is truly an honor to introduce Dr. Robert George to you today. Dr. George is the McCormick Professor of Jurisprudence at Princeton University. He is the founding director of the James Madison Program in American Ideals and Institutions. He has twice served as chairman of the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. He has served on the President's Council on Bioethics and as a presidential appointee to the United States Commission on Civil Rights. Dr. George is the author of many insightful articles and books, which we encourage our students to read for a clear, uncompromising presentation of natural law, human rights, and human dignity as it applies to today's public policy challenges. Dr. George is a recipient of many honors and awards, including the Presidential Citizens Medal, which is the second highest civilian award bestowed by the President of the United States. Dr. George is a rare academic, not only for his scholarly contributions, but also for his support of academic freedom. He has been an outspoken critic of political correctness, speech codes, and the suppression of freedom of speech and the right to dissent on college campuses. Dr. George's leadership on this important issue was influential in Princeton University's adoption last year of an official policy supporting academic freedom. Conservatives often marvel that this renowned conservative leader is a part of the Princeton faculty at a time when many conservatives are not welcome on college and university campuses. This may say something about Princeton, but it probably says more about our speaker today. Dr. George is courageous and outspoken. He persuasively makes the conservative case for the hot-button issues of our time, from life and marriage to religious liberty and free enterprise. And his insights are not theoretical or safe. He uses social media to comment instantly and strongly on the cultural and public policy events and leaders of the day. If you are one of his nearly 13,000 followers on Twitter, you know he is direct and tough and always principled, charitable, and humble. Humility is a rare quality of someone who has achieved success at his level, which is one of the reasons Dr. George is held in the highest regard by conservatives and liberals alike. Leftist activist Cornel West considers him a good friend. Supreme Court Justice Elena Kagan has praised Dr. George for his sheer brilliance and the range of his knowledge, as well as his deeply principled conviction and profound and enduring integrity. I will end with this. Dr. George works tirelessly to advocate for truth and the cause of freedom. The sheer volume of his work is noteworthy. And yet, somehow, Dr. George always seems to find time to help those who ask for his assistance, especially students. We are honored he takes time out of his busy schedule to speak at this conference every year. Students, you are about to hear from one of the most influential thinkers of our time. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Robert George.
Thank you very much, Kimberly. It's a great honor to be here, and thanks to the Young Americas Foundation for inviting me back every year, and not only for inviting me back, but for inviting me back to talk about whatever I've been thinking about recently. Recently, I've been thinking about the question, what lies at the foundation of the competing ideas, the leading competing ideas and positions in our culture on the great moral questions of the time? Do they hang together as coherent sets of principles, schools of thought, or not? And I thought I would share, since I'm thinking about it, I thought I'd share my thoughts on that with you in part because I suspect that as millennials or post-millennials, whatever we're supposed to call you guys these days, I lose track, you've probably been catechized in a set of ideas that you have perhaps in some cases wrestled with, perhaps in some cases just intuitively rejected, in some cases perhaps implicitly accepted, not by your parents, not by your pastors, not by your church, but by the ambient culture, and especially the intellectual culture, by the elite media, by the institutions of education at every level. I'm not just talking about higher education, but K through 12. So this is going to be a different kind of talk from any, I think, that you will hear during your visit here to Washington, D.C., and it might be a bit of work, and I apologize if it's more than a bit of work, but let me launch into it and see what you think. The ancient heresy known as Gnosticism never quite goes away. I don't know if you've studied Gnosticism in your history courses or philosophy courses or religion courses, but Irenaeus, all the way back in the second Christian century, attacked Gnosticism as a heresy, and the Jewish and Christian traditions both rejected it. And yet, Gnosticism's core ideas have popped up time and again over the centuries, in the Middle Ages, in the Enlightenment period, and today they are back with a vengeance. And my proposition is that they shape the expressive individualism and social liberalism that are ideologically dominant among our culture, our cultural elite, the people and institutions who have sought to catechize your generation and the generation before. These Gnostic ideas are the philosophical driving force of key dimensions of contemporary social liberalism. Now, there have been many forms of Gnosticism. Those of you who have encountered it in your courses know that. Some have been ascetical, others quite the opposite. What they hold in common is an understanding of the human person, an anthropology, a philosophical anthropology, that sharply divides, on the one hand, the material or bodily, and on the other, the spiritual or mental or affective. For Gnostics, it's the immaterial, the mental, the affective that ultimately matters. That is what we are. That's the person in the body. Applied to the human person, this entails that the material or bodily is inferior, if not a prison to escape, certainly a mere instrument to be manipulated to serve the goals of the person, now understood as the spirit or mind or psyche, the conscious and desiring subject, the center of emotion that inhabits and uses a body that is conceived as pure matter. Now, in this dualism of self and body, the self is one thing, the person is one thing, And the body, the human body, is quite another. The self is a mental substance, or to put a religious tinge on it, a spiritual reality. The body is merely its material vehicle. You and I are entirely identified then with the mind or psyche or soul, and not at all, or only in the most attenuated way, with the body, which on this view we merely inhabit or occupy or are somehow mysteriously associated with and use to achieve satisfactions in the true self, in the person, which is considered the psyche. Such dualism, though, contrasts sharply with the view of the human person as a dynamic unity, a personal body, an embodied person, a bodily self. Now, this rival understanding of the person as a unity of body and mind, or body, mind, and spirit, suffuses the Hebrew Scriptures and the Christian tradition. And even further back than Christianity, at least, Aristotle, who broke with his teacher Plato on the point, defends one form of this view of personal unity, what he calls, or what we've come to call, hylomorphism. Without denying the existence of the soul, it affirms that the human person is material, bodily, though not merely material. You and I do not just inhabit or occupy our bodies, we are our bodies, whatever else we are. Our bodies are ourselves, and not vehicles in which the self, considered as the conscious and desiring subject, the center of feeling, emotion, or rationality, lives. The living body, far from being an external instrument, is part of our personal reality. So while it cannot exist apart from the soul, it is not inferior. It shares, the body shares, in our personal dignity. It is the whole of which our soul is, to use the classical language, the substantial form. One can separate living body from soul in analysis, analytically, but not in fact or ontologically. For we are body-soul composites. The body, soul, and soul are inseparable. At death, we die. So we are animals. Rational animals, to be sure, but not pure minds or intellects or centers of feeling or emotion. Our personal identity across time consists in the endurance of the animal organisms we are. Now, why do I go through all this rather abstract philosophy, this philosophical anthropology? To make good on the promise that I gave you at the beginning, for something very crucial follows. For many disputed ethical questions and political questions from adopting one view or the other. If the unity view is correct, if hylomorphism is correct, if the traditional view affirmed in Judaism and Christianity and by classical thinkers such as Aristotle is correct, then the human person comes to be when the human body comes to be, when the human organism comes to be. And the human person survives and survives as a person until the organism ceases to be, until death. Yet we are not brute animals. We're animals, but not brute animals. We are, again, animals with a rational nature. We're rational animals, as Aristotle pointed out. That is, we are organized biologically from the start to exercise rational powers, powers of deliberation, judgment, and choice, conceptual reasoning, and so forth. We always have, at least in root form, in radical form, the capacities for conceptual thought and for practical deliberation and judgment. These powers are not reducible to the merely material. Creatures possessing them are, under favoring conditions, able to grasp intelligible, not merely sensible, features of options for action, and to respond to these reasons with choices not determined by antecedent events. In other words, we possess, in virtue of our rationality, freedom of the will. Sometimes we cause things to happen. We bring about states of affairs that we are not caused to cause. That's what it means to have rationality and freedom. It's not that we act arbitrarily or randomly, but that we choose based on intelligible reasons, judgments of value that incline us toward different options without compelling us. So there is no contradiction on the hylomorphic view of the person between our animality, and we are indeed animals, and our rationality, and we are not mere brute animals. But let's return to the neo-Gnostic subordination of the person as conscious subject to a body conceived as merely material. A little reflection reveals how this view helps to drive liberalism's expressive individualist ideology on a range of ethical questions. If human beings are purely mental substances, then human beings are not necessarily persons, and not all human beings are persons. In that case, those human beings in the embryonic, fetal, and early infant stages of development are not yet persons. They are human beings, living members of the species Homo sapiens. Candid and clear-thinking defenders of abortion, such as my Princeton colleague Peter Singer, happily concede that and criticize people on their own side for denying it. Of course, abortion ends the life of a living human being, a member of the species Homo sapiens, and yet, for people who adopt the neo-Gnostic view, that can be okay because not all human beings are persons. Some human beings are pre-personal, embryos, fetuses, and for Singer, even newborn infants are not yet persons. And those who have lost the immediately exercisable capacity for characteristically human mental functions, victims of advanced dementias or long-term comas, or those in minimally conscious states, are on the neo-Gnostic view no longer persons. Yes, they once were, and they remain human beings. They haven't turned into apples or alligators. But they are no longer persons. They have a life, a human life, but not a personal life. And so they, too, can be done away with by euthanasia. And those with severe congenital cognitive disabilities aren't now, never were, and never will be persons. So do you see how the neo-Gnostic division between body and person underwrites the liberal impulse to justify abortion, euthanasia, certain forms of eugenic killing? But of course, the reality is that it's the human person who is a bearer of dignity and worth. It's personal life that we have reason to hold inviolate against harm. We can freely use, legitimately use other creatures for our purposes. We shouldn't be cruel to them, but we don't regard them or shouldn't regard them as having fundamental human rights or fundamental rights like human beings. So someone who buys into neo-Gnostic anthropology really will find it easier to justify abortion, the production and use and destruction of human embryos in biomedical research, euthanasia, and so forth. Now, by the same token, look at how it extends. Neo-Gnostic ideology underwrites social liberalism's rejection of traditional marital and sexual ethics and traditional morality's vision of marriage as a male-female union. Do you notice? I think it's not a new revelation to you that historically Christianity, Judaism, classical thinkers from Plato and Aristotle to Musonius and Xenophanes and Plutarch, and other traditions of philosophy and religion, East and West, have all understood marriage as a male-female union. How did that happen? since it's supposed to be so irrational to think that marriage could be such a thing. Well, let's explore that. In the neo-Gnostic understanding of human anthropology of the human person, the idea of marriage as a male-female union, no matter how many great philosophers and great traditions of thought have affirmed it, makes no sense. It's just a complete puzzle. The only reason anybody could hold it is, I don't know, bigotry. Because if the body is a mere instrument of the person and not part of the personal reality of the human being, its purpose, its point, is to be used to satisfy subjective goals or produce desirable feelings in the person considered as the conscious subject, the thinking, feeling individual. And if we are not our bodies, but merely inhabit and use them as extrinsic instruments, then marriage simply cannot be what Jewish and Christian and classical ethics hold it to be, the one flesh union of man and woman, made possible precisely by the biological reproductive complementarity of male and female. For if the body is not part of the personal reality of the human being, but merely its instrument, there can be nothing morally or humanly important about merely biological union, apart from its contingent psychological effects, how it makes you feel. So on the neo-Gnostic dualistic understanding of the human person, sexual issues are just issues about how you arrange the plumbing. Once you get past consent, that's, of course, an important criterion, but once you've got consent, or consenting adults, although the adult thing is fading fast, once you get consenting adults, then it really is just irrelevant what turns you on. It's just satisfactions. By the same token, neo-Gnosticism makes it harder to appreciate that marriage is a natural, pre-political, and even pre-religious human good with its own objective structure as a one-flesh union, as a comprehensive sharing of life whose foundation and matrix is the biological union of male and female made possible by sexual reproductive complementarity. If sexuality is just a means to our subjective ends, and if we can't even contemplate that it could be anything else, isn't it just whatever we want it to be? How could it be oriented to procreation, as historically people across the world and across the traditions of thought? Or how could it call for permanence or exclusivity? Why isn't it a 5-year contract renewable? Why can't it be open, multiple partners? We can make sense of this one flesh union conception of marriage only if we understand the body not as the vehicle of the self or the extrinsic instrument of the self considered as the conscious and desiring subject, but rather as truly personal, as part of the personal reality of the human being, inseparable from our rationality. Then we can see the biological union of man and woman achieved like the biological union of parts within a person, making you a functioning organism, through coordination toward a single bodily end of the whole, for the couple, of course, reproduction, as a distinct union of persons. Then its orientation to family life can have human and moral and not merely biological significance, because there is then no such thing as the merely biological. Biological union is an aspect of personal union because the body is part of the personal reality of the human being and not a subpersonal and extrinsic instrument. Then spouses can choose bodily union to renew the all-encompassing unity that is their marriage. This vision in turn helps us to make sense of the natural desire to rear one's own children and the normative importance of committing to do so whenever possible, even at great personal cost. on the neo-Gnostic view, and the next time you're talking with a really strongly committed socially liberal friend, just ask him or her, why should a woman who goes to the hospital or birthing center and gives birth to a baby have a right to be sent home with her own baby? Why shouldn't she just be given a baby from the pool? You contribute one, you get one. Why couldn't it be randomly chosen? Why should it be her biological child? Questions like that suddenly become unanswerable once you've adopted the neo-Gnostic anthropology that is driving liberal social ethics. The opposite view, the view of Aristotle, the view embraced by Judaism and Christianity, makes sense of a sound sexual ethics, which specifies the requirements of faithful conjugal and parental love. But an ethic that will seem cruel and pointless to the latter-day Gnostic. I guarantee you the folks in Philadelphia at the convention think that traditional ideas about marriage and sexual morality are both pointless. How did anybody ever come up with that stuff? And cruel, because they deny people stuff they really want. They make it impossible for people to experience self-realization and true fulfillment, to be who I really am, to affirm my deep identity. For neo-Gnostics, after all, what matters is what goes on in the mind or consciousness, not the body or rest of the body. True personal unity, to the extent that it's possible at all, is unity at the affective level, not the biological one. Marriage tends to be seen then as a union at the affective level, not the bodily one, at the affective level. Marriage tends to be seen as, yes, you've heard it before, a socially constructed institution, not a natural one, that exists, why? For instrumental purposes. What? To facilitate desirable romantic bonds and to protect and advance various feelings and interests of people who enter into such bonds. It's not a conjugal partnership at all, but rather it's redefined, re-understood, repurposed as a form of sexual romantic companionship or domestic partnership, something completely alien to the concept of marriage as historically understood, that is, understood as a conjugal relationship. Procreation and children are, at best, only contingently related to it. There's no sense, even an indirect one, in which marriage is a procreative partnership or a partnership whose structure and norms are shaped by an inherent orientation to procreation and the rearing of children, as Aristotle would have said, as St. Augustine would have said, as Maimonides would have said, as Kant would have said, as everybody until yesterday understood. The conjugal conception of marriage, formerly known as marriage, as a union of the sort that would naturally be fulfilled by spouses having and bringing up children together, even if for any particular couple that's not possible, strikes the ear of the neo-Gnostic as unintelligible and even bizarre. I mean, it's an amazing thing when you think about it. Something that was the common understanding across cultures and traditions, and the understanding of the greatest minds who ever lived, is now something so puzzling that social liberals can't understand why anybody could ever have thought it. It's not that they understand why some people thought it, but they themselves reject it. They can't understand why anybody would ever conceivably have thought it. What's going on, of course, is they have implicitly bought into the neo-Gnostic answer to a question that it's never occurred to them to even ask. They don't know they've affirmed a neo-Gnostic dualistic understanding of philosophical anthropology, of the relation of person and body. They don't even know the questions there. And yet, their view of that is driving their understanding of marriage and making it impossible for them even to credit as conceivable, as something that could be affirmed apart from bigotry or irrationality, as a position that an intelligent person could hold. Indeed, on the neo-Gnostic view, sex itself is not an inherent aspect of marriage or part of its meaning. The idea of marital consummation, something that not just the law of the church, but the law of the state always held as central in family law, in marital law, seems bizarre. I've had this conversation with some of my friends, my academic friends, even some of my friends who write in this area and defend liberal positions on sex and marriage. And I've never had anybody explain to me how consummation as a requirement of marriage, for a marriage to be perfected and not subject to nullability, could be intelligibly grounded. They can't give any historical account of why the law ever had a consummation requirement or made anything for legal purposes in matrimonial law depend on consummation. This whole business with Henry VIII, that was based on just a profound misunderstanding, I guess. Remember Henry VIII, the whole question of Henry VIII's legitimacy of Henry VIII's marriage to Anne Boleyn had to do with whether Henry's actual wife, Catherine of Aragon, had consummated her marriage to Henry's elder brother before he died. Well, why would anybody have thought consummation mattered? The English Reformation needn't have happened. Sometimes I think maybe not such a bad idea. Now, just as for social liberals, two people can have perfectly legitimate and valuable sex without being married to each other, so two or more people, say a threesome, a so-called throuple, or a quadrat, or a quintet, can have a perfectly valid and complete marriage without sex. Consummation just can't make any sense as a requirement, as something integral to marriage. It's all a matter, on the liberal view, of the partner's subjective preferences. Consensual sexual play is valuable just insofar as it induces or enables the partners to express desired feelings of affection, for example, or for that matter, of domination and submission. It doesn't matter. The content doesn't matter. But if they happen, the couple or throuple or quadrat or quintet happens not to experience desire for sex, sex would then be pointless within a marriage. Imagining that a marriage is finalized or completed or perfected by consummation, again, is just irrational. Sex is merely, like children, sex and procreation are both merely incidental and therefore optional. It's like a couple deciding whether to own a car or have a joint bank account. Different strokes for different folks. The essence of marriage on the liberal view is companionship, not sex, nor an orientation to procreation. And all of this explains, of course, why marriage as a matter of neo-Gnostic ideology need not be between persons of opposite sexes. And it suggests that marriage can exist among three or more individuals in polyamorous sexual or non-sexual groups. If you've been paying attention, you will have noticed that polyamory is the next thing lying just beyond transgenderism. Polyamory has now been presented sympathetically as an option that people can consider embracing and that the law perhaps should consider recognizing by articles in the Atlantic Monthly, in People Magazine, in Newsweek, and on and on and on. Because marriage on the neo-Gnostic liberal view swings free of biology and is distinguished simply by its emotional intensity and quality, the true person being the conscious and feeling self, same-sex and polyamorous marriages are possible and valuable in the same basic ways as the conjugal union of man and woman. For partners in these other groupings, too, can do what? Feel affection for each other? And even believe that the quality of their romantic partnership will be enhanced by mutually agreeable sex play. If that's what marriage is all about, then denying the throuple or the quadrat or the quintet marital status means denying them marriage equality. If you're serious about marriage equality, you have to grant it, because that's what equality means once you've embraced neo-Gnostic dualism and what follows from it. for sex and marriage. And then there is transgenderism or transsexualism. If we are our minds and merely inhabit material bodies, then of course the body should be made to conform to the mind. If we are body-mind composites and not minds or souls merely inhabiting material bodies, then respect for the person demands respect for the body, which rules out mutilation or other direct attacks on human health or physical integrity. Then we are, except in extraordinarily rare cases of deformity to the extreme of true indeterminacy, and I mean extraordinarily rare, males or females. Our maleness or femaleness, constituted by our basic biological organization with respect to biological reproductive functioning, is an inherent part of who we are, because our bodies are not just the vehicles in which we reside as males or females or whatever. Changing sexes is metaphysically impossible because it is biologically impossible. Desiring to change sexes is a pathology, a wish to cease being oneself and to be someone else. It's not to will one's good, but to will one's non-existence as who one is. Now, this is not to deny the reality of gender dysphoria. People really do, in some cases, feel as though they are one sex inhabiting the body of another sex. And that is a powerful feeling and can feel, by all accounts, like a kind of torture demanding some sort of relief. But once we have rejected neo-Gnostic dualism, we can see that the way to try to relieve it is not through imagining that one is what one could not be, a spiritual female inhabiting the body of a male or what have you. By contrast, on the neo-Gnostic view, no dimension of our personal identity is truly determined biologically. If you feel as though you are a woman trapped in a man's body, then that's just what you are, a woman. And you may legitimately describe yourself as a woman despite the fact that you are biologically male and take steps, even to the point of amputations and hormone treatments, to achieve a feminine outward appearance, especially where you think doing so will enable you more fully to feel like a woman, to be who you think you really are. Because the body, on the neo-Gnostic view, serves at the pleasure, so to speak, of the conscious self, which is the true subject, the mutilations and other procedures pose no inherent moral problem. It's just bringing the material, which is merely a vehicle, merely extrinsic, doesn't matter, bringing the body into line with the mind or spirit or center of feeling and emotion. At the same time, surgical and even purely cosmetic changes are not necessary for a male to be a woman or a female to be a man, which explains why now at some colleges, the vagina monologues has come under criticism because it's understood as being a form of discrimination or prejudice against women who don't have vaginas. That is, women who are biologically male. That wasn't the reason I opposed the vagina monologues, but it's now the fashionable reason to oppose the vagina monologues. The body and its appearance simply do not matter, except instrumentally. Since your body is not the real you, on the neo-Gnostic view, your sex, your biological sex, and even your appearance need not line up with your gender, which is not a biological phenomenon, but a psychological category, so long as you and others can proceed smoothly enough as if you are what you feel yourself to be. And then we can get very moralistic about all that and demand that people be fined $250,000 in New York for misgendering an employee. And of course, since feelings, including feelings about what or who you are, fall on a spectrum, and are even fluid, changing, you are not limited to only two possibilities on the question of so-called gender identity. You may be gender nonconforming, nor are you permanently locked in to any particular gender. There is the full Facebook 56 or 58 or whatever the number is today. And you can find your gender changing over time or abruptly. It may even be possible to change genders by acts of the will. You might change genders temporarily, for example, for political reasons or for the sake of expressing solidarity with others. And of course, most of these observations about so-called gender identity can extend to the concept of sexual orientation, a concept that emerges only in the 19th century, and the practice of self-identifying in terms of sexual desire, a concept and practice very well served by neo-Gnostic ideology. Now, the anti-Gnostic position was, as I said, historically embraced by Jews and Christians, and in the case of Christians, Eastern as well as Western, Protestant as well as Catholic. But since it has come under such challenge today, if only implicitly ordinarily, we must ask, were the Christians and the Jews and those classical figures like Aristotle who rejected it right to reject Gnostic dualism? Might that dualism have been right all along? Perhaps it's that modern liberals have simply rediscovered the truth that had been obscured about philosophical anthropology by Judaism and Christianity and the classical tradition. Perhaps the person is not the body, but merely inhabits and uses it as an extrinsic instrument. Maybe this is just material stuff that you see that I, whom you don't see, live in and maneuver and manipulate the way the driver in a car moves and manipulates the car, although the car is purely, obviously, merely an extrinsic instrument. It's not part of the driver. Perhaps the real person, the real you or the real me, is the conscious and desiring self, the psyche. And the body is just material stuff, the machine in which the ghost resides. Now, as you've worked out, I don't think so. I don't think that's right. I think that Aristotle and the other classical thinkers who followed him and the Jewish and Christian traditions got it absolutely right. Indeed, our entire experience of ourselves as acting persons is the experience of being unified actors. And nothing gives us reason to suppose that that experience is illusory. Even if self-body dualism can be made coherent as a philosophical view, we would have no more reason to embrace it than we have to think that we are now dreaming this experience or that we're stuck in the matrix. See, it's logically possible, is it not, for any of us, you there, right? It's logically possible that you are dreaming, that this isn't happening, that you're actually, I don't know, in Tuscaloosa. But you're dreaming being in Washington, D.C. at the Young Americas Foundation, where you came to hear important politicians, and there's some professor rattling on about the unintelligible stuff. It's just a dream. Bad dream, nightmare. Logically possible, but of course you have no reason to suppose that it's just a dream. You have every reason to suppose that it's, for better or worse, your reality. And the same is true. Even if you could make person-body or self-body dualism logically coherent, you'd have no more reason to doubt your experience as an acting person of being a unified actor. You'd have no more reason to doubt that than you have to suppose you're sleeping now. But even apart from that powerful point, there are powerful affirmative arguments against body-self dualism. My friend and co-author, Professor Patrick Lee, and I outlined the basic steps of a central argument against dualism that we present in detail in our book, Body-Self Dualism in Contemporary Ethics and Politics, available in paperback from Cambridge University Press. And I'm just going to quote the core of the one of the arguments, one of the central arguments we make there, because I think it'll help you to understand why I think it ought to be rejected, why person-body dualism, neo-Gnostic dualism ought to be rejected. So, here goes. Sensing, Right, sensing. Seeing, hearing, smelling. Sensing is a bodily action performed by a living being. Might or might not be a human being. We recently welcomed a fox to the little wooded area of our lawn, and the fox senses. Your pet dog senses, or cat. Sensing is a bodily action performed by a living being. Therefore, the agent that performs the act of sensing is a bodily entity, an animal. But in rational animals, human beings, it's the same agent that performs the act of sensing and that performs the act of understanding, including conceptual self-awareness, something that we can only presume the fox and even your dog doesn't do. Therefore, continuing in human beings, the agent that performs the act of understanding, including conceptual self-awareness, is a bodily entity and not a spiritual or psychic entity making use of the body as an extrinsic instrument, unquote. Now, to illustrate the point Professor Lee and I are making, let me invite you to perform an act of sensing right now. I'll hold up an object for you to perceive visually, to sense, okay? Everybody, see it. Now, if there's anybody here who has a visual impairment and can't see what I'm holding up, I'll tell you that I'm holding up a cell phone. Right. Now, you are perceiving, seeing what I'm holding in my hand, right? And you're not only perceiving, considered as an act of receiving impressions, a kind of data through the medium of vision, you're not only doing that, you are understanding what it is that you are perceiving. You're understanding that this is a cell phone, not an elephant, or my last will and testament, or tomato. So there's mental activity going on. You perceive that this is a, as it happens, a smartphone. Now, what exactly is the entity, namely you, that is doing the perceiving and understanding? And more to the point, is it, are you, one entity doing the perceiving and understanding, or two? Perception or perceiving is indeed a bodily act. After all, non-rational animals, the fox, the dog, perceive. But is it not the same entity, namely you as a unified actor, that is perceiving the cell phone and understanding it as a cell phone, not a parakeet, not my birth certificate? It would make no sense, would it, to suppose that the body is doing the perceiving and the mind, considered as an ontologically separate and distinct substance, is doing the understanding. For one thing, you'd end up in an inexplicability or an infinite regress of explanations in trying to account for the relationship between the two substances. How does the actor get from the perception, non-rational act, to the understanding, rational act? We wouldn't be able to make sense of the idea that you are doing the understanding, but an instrument of yours and not you yourself as a unified actor is doing the perceiving. Sensation, as I said, is an animal function. The agent sensing the particular, that thing there, the cell phone, must be an animal. And predication is a personal act. The agent applying a universal concept, cell phone, must be a person. It follows that the person, the subject, performing the act of judging, the judging being that thing is a cell phone, not a birth certificate, not a parakeet, is one being, both personal and animal, a rational animal. So we're not and can't be two separate entities, nor can person plausibly be just a stage in the life of a human animal, as Professor Singer imagines. If it were, after all, a radical difference in kinds of moral status, person versus non-person, would be based on a mere difference in degree of the development of some kind of human capacity that we all have in root form simply in virtue of being human beings, rational animals, rational organisms, which is absurd. So neo-Gnostic dualism is false. We have every reason to believe it's false. It is ultimately intellectually not defensible. We are at every moment of our existence, from the earliest stage onward, bodily selves, personal bodies. We don't move from being non-personal humans, human beings who are not persons, to being human beings who are persons. In the domain of moral thought and practice, there are few projects more urgent than recovering the insight that human persons are indeed dynamic unities, creatures whose bodies are parts of their very selves, aspects of their personal reality, not extrinsic instruments, that our bodies as such share in our dignity as human persons. The project of neo-Gnostic ethics rests on an error. The tragic mistake behind so many efforts to justify and even immunize from moral criticism, or make you feel ashamed even to offer moral criticism, or to think about it, acts and practices that are in truth contrary to our profound, inherent, and equal dignity. The catechism that has been presented to you in the elite sector of the culture since you were in the cradle deserves to be severely criticized and rejected. Thank you. We'll start there and move over there. We'll go back and forth between the two. I'd love to know who you are and which university or college.
Oh, hi, I'm Marlena, and I actually live.
Can you turn her microphone up, please?
I'm so tall. I'm Marlena, and I actually live in Princeton, and I went to K-12 there. So I'm thrilled to hear you speak. I go to Rutgers University, and I'm actually going to be an RA next year. And we had to take a mandatory diversity and white privilege class. And at the end, we had to sign a statement saying that we acknowledged our white privilege. So I wanted to, I know it's ridiculous. I wanted to know what you thought of white guilt and this trend in big public universities.
I believe in academic freedom. You know, I don't like catechism. I think there's a place for catechism class. It's called Sunday school. Rutgers University is not a Sunday school, nor is Ohio State, nor is Princeton, nor is Notre Dame, for that matter. Right? I think religious universities can have some different standards, but even religious universities need to respect the freedom of students to question and faculty to question, to criticize, to raise objections to the prevailing intellectual orthodoxies or to anything else. I mean, what you're being subjected to is a form of indoctrination and thought control. And what that tells me, of course, is that the people who are behind that don't have a lot of faith that their own ideas could stand up in the marketplace, could stand up to serious, rigorous intellectual criticism. There's something I would go so far as to say. Now, we're not talking about gulags here, obviously. But I would go so far as to say that the method here, the method, is Stalinist. What was central about Stalinism to the method, not to the gulags? It was forcing you to say things you didn't believe to be true. Going beyond forcing you not to say things you do believe to be true, the kind of standard violation of free speech, stopping you from speaking. This goes beyond that. This is forcing you to affirm things you don't believe. That's a profound assault on the human conscience. And I don't care if it's a small matter or a big matter. Now, this is a fairly big matter. It's not gulags, but it's a fairly big matter in your life. It pertains to your vocation. Did you say that you were becoming a nurse? Is that?
I'm an RA.
Okay. So it's a big enough deal to you, and that accompanied put on top of the fact that it's undermining the foundational premises and purposes of liberal education means that it's a really big problem as far as I'm concerned. And that's quite apart from the question of race or the substance of an argument over whether some white privilege and what counts as white and what counts as privilege. All that, I'm really happy to have that argument. What I'm not happy with is you being forced in a Stalinist manner to affirm something you may not believe. That's not education. That's indoctrination. Yep.
Hi, and thank you for being with us for today. I'm Christina Hughes, and I'm from Lexington, North Carolina. I attend Wingate University. My question is, I have a lot of people who very strongly believe in traditional values, traditional marriage, gender as a matter of biology and not choice, all of that. But where I have disagreements with them is they say that, well, we should pass laws allowing that because we're in America and people have the freedom to make those choices. What do you say to that train of thought?
I'm having trouble even understanding what the claim is. It's that...
I meet a lot of people who believe in traditional values, such as traditional marriage.
Oh, but they think that they shouldn't act politically on the view that...
Right. Because it's a matter of personal freedom for those people to do as they please.
Okay. Well, what we affirm as marital, what we affirm as male or female, for purposes of our legal and political institutions, is a matter of social choice. There is no neutrality. The law will either affirm the idea of marriage as a conjugal partnership, or it will affirm the competing idea of marriage as sexual romantic companionship or domestic partnership. There is no other alternative, unless what's not going to happen, which is the law simply going out of the marriage business. There's a kind of libertarian fantasy that that could happen. There are lots of reasons why it couldn't, and it shouldn't. So the law is going to make a stand. The law is going to embody a particular point of view. Now the question is which one? And I think all of us have to vie for, using the freedom available to us as democratic citizens, as citizens of a Republican regime of government, to vie for what we think the common good requires, what we think the interests of men, women, children, families, communities, the nation actually is. Right? I don't want some special extra vote. I want the same vote Hillary Clinton has. She gets one, I get one. And then let's vie for the allegiance of our fellow citizens. Let's go out there and have the debate. Now, it'd be great if we could pitch the debate at the level at which I pitched my presentation to you today. We probably can't do that, but we can make the debate at a level, we can engage our fellow citizens at a level that I think just about every decently educated person can understand. Now, one way to avoid having that debate is for the Supreme Court to sweep in and take the debate away from the people. And of course, that's what happens time and time again. And it doesn't just happen because, oh gosh darn, those judges, they just can't stay out. The entire liberal movement is pressing the courts, is commandeering the courts into trying to remove the issues from the public domain so that they can be resolved favorably to elite opinion. If you got an elite view and a popular view, and they conflict, if the division is between the elite and popular view, over time it's probably a lot better if you favor the elite view, as far as getting victories is concerned, to let them be resolved in courts, which are over the long term much more likely to reflect elite opinion than popular opinion. But we have no reason in principle in advance to believe that elite opinion is more reliably true.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, my name is Ashley, and I'm a government student at the University of Texas. And my question is, in a society where we're conditioned to believe that morality is relative, by whom C.S. Lewis calls Gaius and Titius, what is the best way to roll back that conditioning and to reintroduce the natural law?
It is to exercise your freedom of speech to make the case to your friends and to your fellow citizens. The fundamental problem we have is not that we're not allowed to speak our minds. There are lots of efforts to shut down freedom of speech. Kirsten Powers, who, of course, is a Democrat and a liberal, has written a powerful book exposing those efforts. But we still have our freedom of speech, and as we protect it, we should also be exercising it. I think the problem is less that we are, at the moment at least, that we're forbidden to speak than it is that we are afraid to speak. Cowardice is our problem. We need to be equipped, equip ourselves, this week should help you, equip ourselves to make the argument, and then we have to have the courage to go out there and make it. And we have to make it in a serious way. That means by engaging people on the other side, not shouting at them, not manipulating them, but actually listening to what they have to say, listening to their counterarguments, and insisting that they listen to ours, to genuinely engage them. That's the way to overcome the relativism of the contemporary culture. I think the thing fundamentally standing in the way is that we allow ourselves, people who hold natural law views, traditional views, classical views, Judeo-Christian views, allow themselves to be bullied, allow themselves to be made afraid. You don't have anything to be afraid of. Go out there and fight. Thanks. Thank you so much.
Let's keep it going for Dr. George. All right, we're going to take a quick 5-minute break. Feel free to grab some coffee, snacks, or use the restroom, but please be back in your seats within 5 minutes.